And good afternoon, depending on where you are joining us from. I'm Nicholas Bornolis-Plink, and I'm delighted and honored to welcome you to the third of the series of webinars that we have initiated, aimed to inform the global investment community on trends and developments about Greece, and raise the profile of Greece as a business and investment destination. One of the key topics that the foreign investment community has been talking about and concerned has been the attribution of justice, and specifically the bankruptcy and restructuring law in Greece. So we are hosting a webinar today on this very critical topic. The topic is the new Greek insolvency code, a unified framework for early warning, preventive restructuring and bankruptcy, and debt release. This webinar is intended to serve as an introduction to the new insolvency provisions expected to come into effect in Greece as of the beginning of 2021, next year. The code is styled Code for Debt, Settlement, and Second Chance. This bill is no less than a revolution for Greece. It introduces a unified code for restructuring and bankruptcy of individual and corporate debt for the first time in the country's history. It implements directly the recent European Union Directive on Restructuring and Insolvency, actually ahead of all other member states. As such, the new code should also help Greece better participate in the European Union Banking and Markets Union. We have with us a team of legal experts. Actually, I would say more than a team of legal experts. These gentlemen are those who have put together the provisions of the new law. So this is the team that drafted the law. Please take note of that. So we are having here the legal architects of this new law. And this will be presented to the Parliament for discussion next week. So we have a pioneering topic. I would like to thank them all for joining. And I will pass the floor to Mr. Fotis Kourmousis, who is the Special Secretary for Private Debt Management at the Ministry of Finance. Mr. Kourmousis will be acting as the moderator, and he is going to be the one to introduce our panelists. So Fotis, please take over from me.
Nikos, thank you very much. It's an honor to be here and present this new law to have together with us the four legal minds that drafted the law. There is a Greek saying, whenever somebody reads the law and doesn't understand what it says, we always say to one another, what did the legal poet mean? So we don't call them lawyers, we call them poets. So today we have the legal poets, the one that drafted this law, which consists of several parts. I will just speak for 2 minutes to describe these three parts and then pass on the floor to the speakers to themselves touch upon the significant issues of this new piece of legislation. So this new law is actually a code encompassing all existing legislation related to private debt, insolvency, and bankruptcy. It has three axes. The first axis is the preventive phase, so an early warning mechanism to alert debtors that there is indeed a problem and they have to do something about it. The second axis is the preventive restructuring phase in order to settle their debts towards institutional creditors such as bank servicers and public sector creditors. And the third and last axis is the bankruptcy and the discharge of debt. There are special safeguards for strategic defaulters as well as social policies for the primary residents. I'm sure the speakers will touch upon the significant issues and how this law will improve the the investment the environment of the country by setting a clear rules for creditors and debtors. So we have together with us Mr. Stathis Potamitis, who was the leader of the working group, Mr. Alexandros Rokas, Mr. Alexandros Metallinos, and finally, from the judicial sector, Mr. Vasilis Portokalis. Each one of these speakers will focus on the areas of expertise. Each one, let's say, focused on a different part and area of the law, although all of them together, they reviewed all the code. So I pass the floor to Mr. Potamitis to tell us a few things about this new law and especially the parts that he's, let's say, interested in. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Foti. Thank you very much. I will be sharing a little presentation with you. Here we are. So my focus is going to be on this bankruptcy proceeding because, as Fotis just mentioned, the code covers preemptive proceedings as well. Our approach to the bankruptcy proceeding is based on what we identified as deficiencies in what we have in place today. Greece has had the bankruptcy code since 2007 and it has bankruptcy laws for many years based on the commercial code of France. We have identified a number of deficiencies. Let me just focus on some of them. First of all, we have noted that the bankruptcy proceeding that's in place today is used very infrequently. You have fewer than 200 bankruptcies a year, whereas in fact you have tens of thousands of zombie companies, companies which are abandoned as opposed to going into bankruptcy. The second area of problems we have identified has to do with the lack of a clear path to debt discharge. Greece has not had a consumer bankruptcy statute. It has had a substitute in the Katselis law, but that's a particularly problematic statute. And since merchants very infrequently used bankruptcy, they also lacked a path to debt discharge. That has also impacted negotiations between debtors and creditors because bankruptcy is not a credible threat either way. And debtors could not use it as a way to get rid of the debt, and creditors could not use it as a threat to impose some discipline to their negotiations. And another area that we identified as being very problematic is excessive procedural complexity. That has had, as a result, significant delays. It's also a function of lack of expertise and generally an emphasis on procedure as opposed to substantive resolution of the issues. Against this background, we have drafted the new code and it includes a number of significant reforms. I would like to focus on four. The first one is the speeding up of liquidation. Instead of liquidation starting at the state of union of creditors, as is currently identified in the code, liquidation starts right away. We've strengthened the role of creditors. We have introduced a digital registry for all announcements, communications, and registration of procedural steps. And last but not least, we introduced consumer bankruptcy as an integral part of the bankruptcy code. The ways in which we approach the speeding up of liquidation has to do, first of all, with the bifurcation of the proceedings right at the outset. The court, when it declares bankruptcy, decides whether to go to a piecemeal liquidation or to a going concern liquidation. So we shorten the waiting period between the declaration and the beginning of liquidation. Going concern liquidation, which is based on the existing special administration proceeding, requires significant support from creditors. The special administration proceedings are streamlined selling of the business as a going concern in one or more parts. It could also include distinct assets. It involves a public sale without a minimum price. And we've seen in practice that where applied, not only did it produce swift outcomes, but also better recovery than expected. For peaceful liquidation, we have sale of assets through the e-auction platform. And we have addressed the problem of delays caused by minimum prices. Minimum prices are set by an estimate, an assessor, and they are subject to automatic adjustment as opposed to variation by court decision. We have reason to expect that liquidation will conclude, the liquidation part of the proceeding will conclude within something like 8 months, even in difficult cases where the initial auctions are not successful. And last but not least, disputes among creditors do not delay the liquidation, and they are all heard at one hearing at the time of distribution. Coming now to the strengthening of the role of creditors, they influence the appointment of the administrator to a very significant extent. That is compared to the current system of random selection. So this should make a very important difference to the impact of creditor preferences on running of the proceeding. There are various ways that creditors can obtain information from the administrator, much more so than under the current rules. Creditors are given the right to sue management for trading while insolvent. This is something that's not in our statute today. Quite critically, bankruptcy will not impact enforcement by secured creditors, except in the case where there's a pending application or a decision to sell on a going concern basis. And last but not least, we have tried to reduce procedural privileges with tax authorities and the social security funds. We've tried overall to create a more equal environment, a more level playing field for the creditors. I think one of the most exciting reforms is the use of a digital registry for all announcements, communications, and all procedural steps. Publications, say, decisions will be made on the digital platform. The platform will also receive communication from creditors for the announcements of the case, for instance. So, yeah, for cross-border creditors as well. It can host assembly voting for creditors. And we will also be able, for the first time, to have a lot of data on the proceedings, so we can compile statistics. And among other things, be able to identify procedural weaknesses for improvements. The fourth change is the introduction of consumer bankruptcy, as I mentioned. The code identifies bankruptcies as being big or small, and there is a simplified process for small bankruptcies. We expect that most consumer bankruptcies would indeed fall into that category. Bankrupt individuals have automatic discharge after on the third anniversary of the declaration of bankruptcy, unless prior to that date creditors object, and they can object for fraud, lack of full disclosure, full cooperation with the bankruptcy organs. There's a special exemption for individuals that contribute significant assets to the estate. They can be discharged in 1 year. And discharge is very broad. It only exempts penalties for certain specific criminal sanctions and for family maintenance. So overall, we introduce a new bankruptcy framework that makes bankruptcy simpler, more transparent, faster, and within fairer. So we hope that way to be able to live up to the purpose of the statute, which is to contribute to a quick restoration of productive means to potentially productive uses, provide creditors with a reasonable recovery, and offer good faith debtors who fail with a second and possibly a third or a fourth chance. This is for me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Potamitis, for this interesting presentation. And now I pass the floor to Mr. Alexandros Rokas.
Before Alexandros starts, if I may remind everybody that you can submit questions to the panelists online. You have the Q&A button and you can submit questions, and then these questions will be replied after our panel discussion is over. I already see a couple coming through, and I encourage you to send us more. So, Mr. Rokas, please.
Thank you, Fotis. Thank you, Nicholas and Capital Link, for this opportunity to discuss restructuring and bankruptcy. Stathis referred to bankruptcy, and I will refer to restructuring, and in particular, the transfer of business, which is a tool, a version of the restructuring procedure. Let me now share my slides with you. So, okay. Now, when we usually refer to corporate reorganizations, what comes to mind are Chapter 11 styled restructurings. These involve the restructuring of the debt, while the selling alternative involves the transfer of the business to a new company, which is usually a company owned by an investor. This version of the US restructuring procedure is well known since the Chrysler reorganization in 2009, which was a very complex case, by the way. In Greece, we have introduced this version of the restructuring procedure in 2011. However, it took about 5 years to have a popular selling procedure. This version of the restructuring procedure is now known as 106D agreements. So this shows us that it's one thing to have a law voted and another thing to have the law recognized in practice. So let me come to the advantages of this selling procedure. The first is flexibility. What is the structure of this deal? The parties, which is, the parties are the debtor, the qualified majority of the creditors, as well as the investor. So the parties select which of the assets, the liabilities, and the contracts will be transferred to the new company. The company which is usually owned by the investor. The company might be also a company set by creditors, but the most usual case is a company set by investors. So even administrative licenses will be transferred to the new company, and that shows how flexible this procedure is. And also it shows, and I come to the second advantage, that the firm's value is preserved. I have to note that this procedure is usually a rapid procedure, and within, say, 6 months, we can have the transfer completed. Finally, I come to the third advantage. In the case of a normal restructuring, I mean restructuring without the transfer of the business, sometimes creditors complain that we have a payment plan ratified by court, but then the debtor in the medium term or in the long run, he's not able to pay according to the payment plan. And why is that? That is because during the years of crisis in Greece, it was quite a hard task to draft business plans. There were a lot of uncertainties involved. While in the case of transfer of business, we have a new person, which is the person of the investor, who is usually a much more solvent entity. So the payment plan is in most cases kept. I have, as a side note, I would like to note that the EU Restructuring Directive includes a reference to the transfer of business in the preamble, but it does not regulate the details of this type of restructuring. So this means that national legislator can include details on the transfer of business because there's no particular regulation in the restructuring directive about transfer. What is regulated in the directive is the general pre-insolvency framework. Now to, I have some examples here of real companies which were restructuring Greece through this 106D procedure. They are mainly large businesses. These companies do not exist anymore because they were transferred to the new company, the company of the investor. We are talking about in-court restructuring, of course, because 106D presupposes a ratification by court. The second case, the Marinopoulos case, was the largest restructuring in Greece until now because Marinopoulos owed around 2 billion euros. The debt was very large. And it's also interesting to note that in the most recent case, the Krita Farms case, through the 106D procedure, even issues relating to shareholders, disagreements between shareholders were able to resolve through this procedure. And it's also interesting to note that even haircut to the debt owed to the state was imposed through the 106D agreement. Now, let's come to the new code and what amendments are expected. The basic amendment which is expected to influence the 106D agreements, which by the way are not going to be any more 106D agreements because the number of the articles has changed. So the new element is the so-called creditor-driven agreement. Here we have 106D agreements which are signed by creditors but without debtor's consent. That is to say the debtor is not signing the restructuring agreement. The business of the debtor is transferred to a new company without debtor's consent. But in order for that to occur, the debtor has to face severe symptoms of crisis in order for the procedure to be justified. So what are these symptoms? The debtor has to face inability to pay. That's a very well-known concept in other countries too. The debtor has to face a significant equity loss, 90% or more. And finally, the financial statements has to be left without submittance for 2 years. One of these three conditions has to be met. In fact, the inability to pay is now being detailed in the law, and that's the case not only in restructuring but also in bankruptcy. And the nuanced assumption which is introduced in the code is the following, that in case the debtor does not pay 40% of the debt owed to the banks or the state for 6 months, then the inability to pay is assumed. And finally, the court can appoint a trustee, a mandataire, who is appointed in order to administrate the debtor's affairs until the ratification of the agreement. That may be very important and useful in case, in order to avoid transfer of assets by the current administration until the ratification is in place. Finally, I have to note that there is another procedure in current laws, the special administration procedure, which is regulated in an emergency law, the Dendias law, and it is in place since 2014. There are some differences if we compare this procedure to 106D proceedings. First, there is always a special administrator who is running the business as and is putting the business to sale. Second, there is a bidding procedure, so the investor will be will show up through this bidding procedure. And third, only assets can be transferred and not liabilities. Now, this procedure will now be integrated in the new code, and it will be actually the alternative to the piecemeal bankruptcy liquidation. Stathis already mentioned this type of the bankruptcy procedure. It's the going concern liquidation. So we keep this procedure, but it's now integrated in bankruptcy. I think that 106D agreements will become even more important after the amendments I mentioned previously. We are happy to discuss any questions, and thank you again.
I'm glad to see we have an avalanche of questions coming through.
Now we move on. More speeches, and then we'll go back to questions from the audience. We still have open time, so sort of.
Is this my turn?
Yes, Alexandros, it's your turn. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Let me. Let me share the screen. I'm going to talk about zombie firms and stranded assets. These are two of the biggest problems we face in the current situation in Greece. Starting with zombie firms, these are firms that are unable to pay part or all of the due and payable debts. Typically, they don't pay anything to the banks, and they they make use of all schemes to pay that are available from time to time to pay taxes and social security contributions late. They generally pay some of their suppliers, but with delays. Now, what happens is that these firms lose value, first of all, because they're unable to invest. And that means that their capital stock becomes depreciated and obsolete. It's very difficult for them to compete. It's impossible for them to have any strategic plans over, you know, just surviving the next day. This is obviously a problem for creditors because the value of the asset depreciates very fast, but it's also a more systemic problem. They tend to create problems for the financial health of competitors because in order to get even a small amount of liquidity to survive the next day, they may sell at prices below the cost of providing the goods and services. That was really typical in firms in the public works sector, where they would bid at very low prices in order to get the upfront payment, and then they would typically try. Well, they would work very slowly. They would do the worst possible work. They try to get the state to pay them extra. All of that would create problems both to them and to competitors. The other problem, the other systemic problem is that they affect suppliers because in particular, if the zombie firm is a big firm like the Marinopoulos supermarket chain was, you may have suppliers who are caught in a vicious circle where they cannot decide whether to cut off supplies, which means that they will probably never be paid because they will be last in line, or to risk throwing good money after bad by giving credit to the debtor. So why do zombie firms survive? Well, they survive, number one, because the immediate alternative for creditors is worse. Also because until now the bankruptcy procedure per se was very, very inefficient for reasons that we're going to come to. And creditors would extend that pretend, as we say. And then the insiders in that business had lots of incentives to keep the business even barely alive. So, you know, they could pay themselves salaries, they could have all kinds of other benefits from this. I have to say that the presentation was done by my daughter, who's much better than I am in doing this. So, a typical stranded asset. I'm not sure this is the most significant one, but I see it every time I go to the court to the port of Piraeus, so it's constantly in my mind. So this is this used to be a big tobacco factory. It's walking distance from the port of Piraeus, and actually on the main road you take to go to the port of Piraeus. It's 32,000 square meters. The company was declared bankrupt in 2006. The creditors tried to sell it for an initial reserve price of 12 million. The courts very, very slowly reduced the initial price because nobody would take it. Latest auction I have been able to find was in 2019. So 13 years after the declaration of bankruptcy, reserve price was 3 million. Again, they didn't manage to sell. I assume that, you know, if nothing changes, they would keep going, reducing the prices, and maybe they'd sell it in 20 years. The value of that for the creditors would be nothing. And the problem is that it's bad for everything. It's bad for the economy because nobody's using the asset. It's bad for the state, nobody's paying taxes on this building. It's bad for the area because, you know, you're having this huge building next to it stops development all in the whole neighborhood. So something has to be done with this. What can be done? One is restructuring, part of what Alexander Rokas just talked about. The procedures, the provisions have been there since 2011. There have been some delays in the ratifications by the courts. It could have been faster, but still these were very effective provisions. Nevertheless, they were not as effective as they could be because they were the carrot, but there was no stick. So in cases where there was no value for equity holders, it was very difficult to reach an agreement. And then these were designed and are designed to save firms that are over indebted, but not fundamentally non-competitive firms. So if something is fundamentally non-competitive as a firm, then the only thing you can do is sell it piecemeal. If you try to save the firm as it is, you just do nothing because even if somebody makes the mistake to buy it, they will continue making losses and they will go bankrupt as well. There has been the possibility of selling the business as a whole. This has been effective since 2014, the Dendias law Alexander mentioned. It is a good procedure to have, but not appropriate for fundamentally non-competitive firms. And the sale of assets, well, the current system is extremely inefficient and it was crucially important to fix it. So the next point is, so how do we deal with this? We had four main reform drivers. One was that we realized that speed is everything. Waiting destroys value. There are many reforms to accelerate things, but the most important one was that we don't wait to verify the claims of the creditors. We start the sales process immediately, whether it's the sale of the business as a whole or a separate part of it or piecemeal, it starts immediately. Then the other fundamental difference, and this is a change in mentality, is our ideology here is that the only real determinant of value is the market. Any valuation by an expert valuer can help with the process of price discovery, but price discovery is only made by the market. If nobody is willing to buy the Keranis factory at whatever the assessor said is the value, then it isn't worth that much. It simply isn't worth that much. So as was mentioned before, we have an automatic reduction of the reserve price, leading ultimately to auctions without a reserve price. Then the idea is everything must go. It is important for the process to get rid of assets that cannot be sold. So in the end, we say that if nobody buys it, then the state will get it because by definition, it has zero or negative value. Now, solving this issue of stranded assets will also help with the problem of zombie firms because it changes the incentives for the parties. The insiders will know that the banks have, or you know, and the creditors in general have a credible alternative, so a credible threat, and the creditors know that they will, yeah, by pushing the company into bankruptcy, then they're not going into a black hole. So that was the main drivers. We hope that by changing this aspect, we can also make the other aspects, the more friendly aspects or like restructuring, more efficient because everybody's minds will be concentrated. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Alexandros, for your presentation on this significant issue. And now I'll pass the floor to Mr. Vasilis Portokalis to give us the judicial aspect.
Good morning or good evening to everybody. I would like myself to thank Mr. Bornozis and Capital Link for the opportunity. Just a note, the Keranis factory is the first candidate to host the new Piraeus courts. It's the building that Alexandros Dalinos projected. So, as it was emphasized by the previous speakers, a basic characteristic of the new code is the simplification of the procedures with the intention of speeding them up. Its provisions aim at the fast return of productive means in productive uses, as Stathis mentioned, either through the procedure of early warning or through their preventive restructuring or through bankruptcy, where we target at the fastest reclaim of debts by the creditors through the liquidation of the bankruptcy assets in market values as they are revealed in the auction. As it is mentioned in the directive for restructuring and insolvency, the speeding up of early warning and restructuring procedures makes the country attractive to investments. In accordance with that, we have to examine the role of the judge in light of the provisions of the new code. This role, of course, is limited in the preventive restructuring procedure, where we have the insolvency court and the bankruptcy procedure, where we have both the insolvency court and the judicial reporter. And not to the procedure of early warning, where there is no judicial interference. The aim of the new code is the speeding up of legal proceedings by abbreviating the deadlines of the oral procedure in courts and also by making them simpler. That is achieved by the limited interference of courts in the decision, the decision-making process and the enhancement of the trustees and the creditors' initiatives, with ultimate goal the acceleration of legal proceedings. Now let's go to in the limits of the preventive restructuring procedure. The involvement of courts there is limited only in the necessary actions, such as the ratification of the restructuring agreement, where the oral procedure is appointed within only 2 months from the application. And the court decision, when all the parties agree, has limited justification. Also, the appointment of a special trustee, if it is needed, to manage the property of the debtor. Also, the action to grant, recall, modify, or extend the provisional measures. And finally, if asked, the court modifies or annuls the restructuring agreement. Can I have the second page, please? Okay, thank you very much. In the limits of the bankruptcy procedure, it is important the fast liquidation of the debtor's assets in order to avoid the decline of its value, as it is mentioned before. Bearing in mind the new code gives more initiatives to the trustee and the creditors and limits the involvement of the court in quality and quantity to only the most important issues. For instance, the trustee is no longer appointed by the court in most of the cases from a catalog of lawyers, but is indicated by the creditors. And in the application, there is a written acceptance from his part. In this way, it is intended that the trustee takes over as soon as possible, and we avoid what is often in the current practice, that the court appointed trustee renounces his appointment and causes further delay because the court has to reappoint the new trustee. In the new code, the replacement of the trustee is accepted only under very strict conditions. Secondly, the court decides for the important issue of liquidating the bankrupt business as an entity or very big and separately functional part of it. Thirdly, in cases where the bankruptcy is declared after application of the debtor itself, and if there is no opposite action from a creditor, the court decision that accepts it has limited justification. Also, the oral procedure before the court, before the insolvency court, is appointed within 20 days. Another provision is that it is given great discretion at the president of the insolvency court to take any provisional measures until the decision is published to the electronic insolvency records to avoid any negative change in the assets of the debtor or decrease of its value. Regarding now the responsibilities of the judiciary reporter, we have also significant changes. We now appoint the first instance judge instead of the president of the court of first instance. Whereas in the small-scale bankruptcies, a magistrate is appointed as a judicial reporter. For the appointment, it is now important in the law and mentioned in the law that the judge has had previous experience or postgraduate or other education in insolvency matters. The judicial reporter makes a proposition to the court also after the oral procedure of the case regarding the acceptance or denial of the application for bankruptcy. The appeal against the ruling of the judicial reporter has to be made within 10 days, a very short deadline, from the publication of the ruling. The judicial reporter can also ask for the help of a financial expert, such as a member of the Greek IRS, or for investigative procedure, in order to assess the actual financial situation and assets of the debtor. The biggest, though, innovation of the new code in the limits of the bankruptcy procedure is the introduction of a much simpler procedure in the small-scale bankruptcies. A bankruptcy is considered as a small-scale one if the debtor's business doesn't fulfill at the time of its last balance sheet 2 out of 3 of the following prerequisites. Firstly, total assets of 350,000 euros, annual turnover after taxes of 700,000 euros, an average of 10 employees during the last period. For these bankruptcies, jurisdiction belongs to the magistrate courts, where the insolvency court is more flexible because there's only one judge in it, in contrast to the insolvency court of the first instance, where it is made up from 3 judges. The magistrates have already previous experience because for the last decade, they had exclusive jurisdiction for the cases of protection of first domicile, also known as cases of Katseli's law, which in context are very similar to the cases of small-scale bankruptcies. In this procedure, the application is made digitally to a special platform. Stathis mentioned before about this platform. And in case that within 30 days of the application, nobody objects this, it is accepted by the court without any justification. If there is an objection, within 65 days from the submission of the application, the parties have to deposit their files, and within 2 months, the court has to reach a decision. So, all in all, if we add the above deadlines, in 5 months maximum from the day of the submission of the application, we have a decision. Generally, all the other procedures are simplified, and for some, the trustee can act without the permission of the judicial reporter. This simple procedure aims at the speeding up of the bankruptcy, and for that reason, if the bankruptcy isn't over in a total of 12 months from the day of the application, the trustee has to answer to the judicial reporter, who can replace him if he doesn't accept his reasons. Thank you very much.
Vasilis, thank you very much for your presentation. Now we quickly move on to replying some of the questions. In order to save time, we have started replying in written form to some of the questions, and I will now read some of these questions to answer them orally, starting from the beginning. One says about receiving the presentation. The presentations have been made available to the organizers and can be sent or provided to you via them. Yes. Another question is about the board of director members or managers that will be released from responsibility of their companies overdue to public sector debts, and whether this will apply to all cases retroactively. I don't know, Mr. Potamitis, could you share some light on that one?
Yes, the law provides one of the transitional provisions that where you have representatives of entities which have gone bankrupt prior to the effect, the law going into effect, they will also benefit from the release from liability, which, just to inform people, applies for debts incurred within the 12-month period prior to the suspect period. So that could go as far back as 3 years before the declaration of bankruptcy. The liability of those individuals has to do with unpaid debts to tax authorities, social security funds, and employees. So it's a limited civil and criminal exposure, which is set by a law outside the bankruptcy environment. Bankruptcy will give those people some protection.
Okay, thank you very much. Another question from Mr. Vessels. It says, did you consider in cases a large person is empty and has no activities or assets, a mandatory rule to dissolve the company because it no longer has any reason to continue to exist, and proposes what they do in the Netherlands? I don't know, maybe it seems like a question about zombie firms, and that's I refer it to Mr. Metalinos. Could you share some light on that one?
This was not part of the discussions in this project law. The point was to deal with companies that cannot, firms that cannot service their debts. There was a discussion, remember, it was never completed in another project, which was the reform of company law to deal with companies that simply have no activity. And there was a provision drafted, but it was never. Never passed. Of course, it was interesting though, because it said that there will be.
Alexandre, I'm sorry, we can't hear you. You're coming. Sorry. I apologize to interrupt you.
Maybe you can just jump in.
You are muted, Alexandre.
Alexandros was saying that this is a company law matter which was considered as part of the company law reform, but it was not adopted.
It would be interesting to consider at a later stage.
Okay. So another question is by Mr. Lazos, related to the bank's concerns about this code and whether something has been done about it or any consideration has been given. I was just beginning to draft the question, but I will say it out loud. All concerns from banks have been taken into account. Several changes were implemented since the last draft of the law, which was open for public consultation in August. This revised draft of the law has been shared with all major institutions, such as the Bank of Greece, HFSF, ECB, European institutions, Commission, etc. And we have been, in written form, received approval or agreement that all concerns have been effectively dealt with. And as you will see, it is not expected to cause any damage as it was initially reported. You will see the final draft, which will be entered into Parliament most probably by next week, has, let's say, addressed all these concerns. Another one from Mr. Olevinsky. I'm sorry if I didn't pronounce it properly. Which proceedings apply to the Greek assets of the foreign owner, the bankrupt in its home country, secondary proceedings, recognition of foreign trustee, etc.? I think it sounds something like for Mr. Portokalis, would you...
Comment. If you want, I can shortly comment.
Ah, bravo, Alexandre, jumping.
actually, it was not related to no one's speech. So there is no alteration to that issue. International insolvency law is not, the Greek rules are not amended. That is to say, we have the EU regulation, which is still in place. We have the UNCITRAL model law, which we have also in Greece, and this is not modified, and national procedural rules too. So these rules continue to apply and secondary procedures can open. That's the most simple answer I can say.
Okay, thank you very much, Alexandre. I don't know if somebody else wants to add something on that, since it was the last question. So I give the floor back to Nicholas to, I don't know if you have some questions for the panel or you'd like to sum up the process.
Well, maybe I can take a couple more minutes. I mean, we have an avalanche of questions. So what we're going to do is we are going to share all the questions coming through with the panelists, so they can be replied to also at a later point of time. So we urge everybody, by the way, you had record attendance, a testimony not only to you, but also to the topic that you are talking about. So anyone who would like to submit questions, send them please at questions@capitallink.com. We will group them all together and give them to the team for further processing. We will have, also, we will make available the slides. If anybody needs the slides, and I'm sure a lot of them would like to access them, please contact us. And we are going to be sharing them with you. There will be a replay, obviously, of this webinar. It will be available on our website. It will be later available on YouTube. But if you need the slides, contact us. And you can, again, contact us, questions@capitallink.com, and we will send them to you. I would like to thank you all. I mean, we can go on and discuss for a long time. I think it has been a very insightful and detailed and professional presentation. This is going to be presented to the Parliament in the next couple of weeks. So I think once this becomes law, it will be really transformative for the attractiveness of Greece as a business and investment destination for foreign investors. This has been one of the topics that has been coming up all the time as a major obstacle. And it's really tremendous that you are tackling it. I would like to thank you all. I'd like to remind our participants that we are trying to create momentum in terms of attention by the international investment community for Greece. This is the third webinar we have been hosting. The fourth one will be on October 27. It will be on another very hot topic on corporate governance, the new landscape for corporate governance in Greece. That has been another major topic. And then, of course, we will culminate with our major online event, 15 and 16 of December. Unfortunately, we will not be able to do it in physically in New York as we do it every year, but we will do it online. And we will bring everybody from everywhere in the world to, you know, to our event in December. And by the way, on a different topic, October 21st and 22nd, we're hosting a major online conference on Greek shipping. I know it's a different topic. It showcases the leadership of Greek shipping, but as a thought leaders, not only as industry leaders. So we urge you to attend that as well. And anyway, enough about me and Capitalink. Thank you to you for a great debate. And I see the questions coming in. I'm sorry to cut it off, and but we will communicate all the questions to you for further reply. Thank you again.